and welcome to join us once again in this edition of the program Meet the Press on Equinox Television. As the Supreme Court begins examining the files of candidates rejected by Elections Cameroon ahead of the senatorial elections, the SDF party says it has entered a gentleman agreement with the ruling CPDM party. Our guest in today's program is the chairman of the SDF, Nijon Fundi. Also in this edition of the program, we talk about the death of the Nigerian writer and icon, that is Chinua Achebe. We go over to Boya in the southwest region and bring you the story of the man who beheads his own father. We hear he has already started naming names at the judicial police where he has been detained pending investigations. Welcome, make yourselves very comfortable. Thank you for staying with us. We begin traditionally with our news briefs, and we're going to tell you how the Islamist Boko Haram group is threatening to carry out a series of bombings and attacks on Cameroonian territory in case their militants reportedly detained in the country are not released. Also in this package, we tell you how the economic capital Douala is already facing the challenge of flooding before even the advent of the rainy season. This is a news briefs, a compilation of the English news service of Equinox Television.
On nous malasse comme la patate. Comment ça nous plaît pas? Le Camerounais souffre.
These Percy traders at Sindok Percy Market are struggling to pick up the leftover of their seeds and other merchandise which have just been destroyed by agents of the Douala City Council. The traders expressed their fury and lamented that they are now close to frustration since feeding their families now would be a very difficult task.
See how we need to suffer. All that must be done.
It is the fifth time that their structures are being demolished, and the Percy traders complain that the market inside is very small to accommodate the traders of Ndok Percy. The agents of the Douala City Council on their part claim the demolition exercise is to embellish the city and also the Ndok Percy locality.
In the heat of all fire incidents in Douala day by day, one name pricks people's minds: the firefighting brigade. These soldiers of fire, as they are fondly called, have for the past weeks been subjected to many interventions.
Nous avons aussi les interventions des personnes qui sont prises de malaise sur la voie publique.
The rainy season is yet to fully come, yet the streets of Douala are already inundated. We are in Akwa, in the economic capital Douala. As you can see for yourselves, the streets are all covered with water.
This is how locals of La Rifouche in Akwa started their day early Tuesday morning. The heavy downpour flooded the streets, preventing most city dwellers from opening their businesses and from circulating freely.
For the first time the people were walking this road, we asked them to step this gutter right down so that the gutter should be deep more than the quantity of water that we are having here. You see, but they don't do it in such a way. They don't do it in that way. But now we are having a lot of water here, so people cannot even come to job in Akwa.
We are now in another neighborhood, still in the economic capital, Douala, where the locals say they are stuck in their houses because the streets are flooded with water. We are precisely in Bonaprizo.
Users of this stretch of road made a U-turn upon discovery of this large and deep pool of water.
The French foreign minister arrives Cameroon about 1 month after the kidnap of 7 French citizens by the group Boko Haram. Laurent Fabius' visit seeks to discuss about their release with Cameroonian and Nigerian authorities. Fabius after Cameroon left to Nigeria.
The purported Islamist militant group Boko Haram used one of the 7 French hostages to pass across their threats. Tangi Mulem Furnim, in the audio message reportedly transcribed by the Nigerian press, said their health situation was fast failing and fear they might simply pass on. Tangi Mulem Furnim quotes the Islamists as saying they will multiply kidnappings and suicide bombings on Cameroonian territory if the Yaounde and Abuja governments did not heed to their demands. The second video published by the Islamist Boko Haram militants comes 25 days after the French nationals, seven of them in number, were kidnapped in Dabanga in the far north region of Cameroon. Thank you sincerely with that package, Anabila, Christobi and Ranibel Satu. We now go to the southwest region where insecurity is said to be on the rise in Limbe subdivision. The governor has instructed hotel owners to beef up security there after some expatriates were attacked in their hotels. We then go over to Boya in the southwest region where we hear the boy who is said to have beheaded his own father has started naming names. This is our regional network.
Security is said to be on the rise in the city of Limbe. At about 12 a.m., a gang of gunmen attack close to 50 white lodged in a hotel in Bobende Limbe 2 subdivision. The white men surrendered at gunpoint before collecting mobile phones, laptops, money, and other electronic gadgets from them. The incident is coming barely some few days after some white were equally attacked at gunpoint by men dressed in black at the Limbe Botanic Gardens. In just under a month, three hotels in Limbe are said to have been visited by men of the underworld. The incident pushed the Southwest Governor, Bernard Okalia Bilai, to call for an emergency security meeting that took place at the Limbe One Council Hall behind closed doors. Information that filtered out of the meeting say proprietors of hotels have been instructed to double their security and to immediately call the forces of law and order when unidentified persons are spotted around their structures. The white who are working at the extension section of the National Oil Refinery Sonara have equally been told not to leave their hotel's premises after work without security. The Southwest boss, this reporter also gathered, gave instruction for a mixed patrol within the city every night, which have started. Along the banks of the sea at Down Beach and the Bukaro, the Limbe City Council is definitely doing all what it takes to beautify this area as renovation work is ongoing. Nevertheless, the collapse of the walls at the banks certainly means that a lot of work needs to be done before the start of the rains. The city is equally witnessing some ongoing project in preparedness of the 50th anniversary celebrations of Cameroon unification. Makeshift structures along Major Street are being demolished. Clandestine parks at Mile One Hill and at Half Mile have been closed. Commercial motorbike riders relegated to the neighborhood. The population of Limbe and its environs, and to a greater extent the nation as a whole, is deprived from fish as a natural source of protein.
That we have gone to the sea this morning, we came back nothing. You know, we are suffering. You know, we are just trying to beg the government that the government should put us hand, help us. You know, at first when we go to the sea like this in the morning, we bring much fish, but now nothing. Chinese have drained the sea, you know, that they are raking fishing. It's too bad.
Fresh fish in Limbe is as expensive as one can imagine. Women in the business of smoked fish say things are really hard on their side. The price for smoked fish in Limbe has witnessed an increase.
8,075.
This is the story. Living beside the water and washing your face with spitting. Up there is my home in Limbe.
This is the headless corpse of a 75-year-old man, Pa Daniel Monti, a retired wada murdered by his son, Matute Gabriel Monti, who further cut off his father's head. Here, at Mulamba,
kilometers into the Mount Cameroon forest. Matute Gabriel Mbonti, who has promised his father death, followed him in the forest. Left alone, Matute seized his father's machete and used in cutting his head. This corpse was discovered by a night hunter. People overheard Matute Gabriel saying that his million has come and taking the father's head down the village in his black bag. Many say this ex-convict Matute was merely executing an assignment, but who must have assigned him? The paramount of Boya, Chief Endeli, seen the sacrilege himself, ordered for the head to be brought from the Boya mortuary for burial that same day.
In a meeting at the wrestling field here in Boya town, the population wants to decide whether the family of Pat Daniel Mbonte, who was killed by his son and his head cut off last Friday, March 15, 2013, to be banished from Boya or not. At the end of the day, it was unanimously accepted that the Mbonte family will be exiled from Boya, but that was not to be immediate, because it was alleged that Gabriel Mbonte, who cut off his father's head and presently at the Boya Central Police Station, has started calling names that need to be investigated and the culprit sanctioned accordingly for sending the Mbonte family without digging out the root cause of this sacrilege was senseless. And the point that the tongue, neck, and the chin of Pat Daniel Mbonte was not seen made the Boya town population to conclude that it was more of a market. Thus, all the parties involved must be fished out that this is the third murder case recorded in 12 months here in Boya town.
Derek Jato, ETV News.
Thank you, Derek Jato and David Sinmaimo, with that package. And just to indicate that investigations into the purported murder case in Boya are still ongoing. Now we talk literature. The famous Nigerian author, the man who wrote Things Fall Apart, Chinua Achebe, passed on within the week. Who is this author and Nobel Peace Prize winner? This is Ranibel Sato with the profile of Chinua Achebe.
Before the announced death of the African literary icon, he stood as an acclaimed writer, poet, human rights defender, and critic of the political scene in his country, Nigeria. He started making a distinction in the literary world in 1958 when he published his first novel, Things Fall Apart, which depicted an African warrior in the battle with imperialism. Over 10 million copies were sold the world over in more than 50 different languages. According to an online Nigerian publication, he is considered by millions as the founder of African literature. He won many awards for his literary pieces, including the Commonwealth Poetry Prize, the Booker Prize, and the 2013 Man Booker International Prize. Meanwhile, the famous independence fighter Nelson Madiba Mandela, reacting to his death, described Chinua Achebe as the man who brought Africa to the rest of the world, in whose company the prison wars came down. Achebe abandoned his career in radio in 1966 for prose when he was believed to have influenced the Biafran War. His career did not only end at the level of writing. In the early 1960s, the novelist was active in Nigerian politics and published novels that reflected and decried the political problems facing the country, including the difficulty of the post-colonial legacy. He leaves behind his wife, his four children, relatives, and the entire literary world to mourn him.
Thank you, Ronnie Bell, with that report on the life and works of Chinua Achebe. I also caught up with a professor of literature of the University of Boya, George Nyamdi, who begins to explain by telephone how he got the news of the death of the Nigerian literary icon, Chinua Achebe.
The death of an icon is always the moment of singular sadness. And I should say, right away, modern letters, and especially African letters, is in a state of mourning. The loss is great. And I think the literary world, but also humankind in general, is in a state of mourning today. Chinua Achebe was not one person that whose fame in modern letters can be duplicated, and we're going to feel the loss for a very long time to come.
What is the impact of the works of Chinua Achebe to literature in Nigeria, Cameroon, and the rest of the world as a whole, Professor Nyamdi?
I think I like the end of your question, because Achebe didn't only impact Africa, it impacted the world at large. Not only because his concerns as a iconic literary figure were essentially humanist, but also because he showed the kind way forward in this very troubled world. Wherever you give examples of the right order, those examples are applicable not only to the place in which you give them, but to the wider society. At the time when Achebe was writing, the world was enchained in stereotypes that were harmful to human nature. And those stereotypes, of course, viewed the African race, the black race, as underdogs in a world held in bondage by materialism and some naive views that thought that human races were graded in order of seniority down, superiority downward. Achebe put faith to that destructive attitude in Things Fall Apart. And I think if the black race is bleeding today, it is precisely because Achebe injected emotion and a sense, a feeling of freedom, equality, and fulfillment among in the black race.
Do you think other writers already are copying Chinua Achebe's footsteps, maybe from the works he wrote, in terms of the content and the form?
Very much so, yes. He trailed a line of thought which I think stands Africa and the black diaspora in very good stead. You know, there is nothing more beneficial, more gratifying than being told that you are a human being endowed with the same potentials, endowed with the same merits like any other human being. And I think if there's any legacy we're going to thank Achebe for, it is that of having opened the black race's eyes to its whole, to its full potential in the world. In Chinua Achebe, we have the hallmark flag bearer of the African consciousness. The succeeding streams of writers and writings all bear the imprint of this originating fictional authority, who is Chinua Achebe. Whatever we do today, and I say it as one person who has tried his hand at writing, whatever we do, we return to the fictional godhead that is Chinua Achebe. Because without him, of course, we would be wondering, would be groping. But I think he lit the light, showed us the way, and our progress and progression down the line of African fiction has been relatively easy and a lot more meaningful.
Thank you, Professor Josh Nyamdi.
You're welcome, and may Professor Chinua Achebe still rest in perfect peace. His legacy is immense.
Now, it is often said that a writer dies, but his artistic prowess and works simply live on. We talk politics now. We told you how the Supreme Court, which is sitting in for the Constitutional Council, is to begin examining the petitions filed in by the different political parties ahead of the senatorial elections after their files were rejected by the elections managing body, that is Elections Cameroon. In the following package, Roland Akong also looks at the re-election of the Speaker of the National Assembly, Kavaya Yege Shibir, who has been there for at least 21 years. It is a must watch.
Following a scrutiny of the files by the members of the electoral board, certain lists submitted by four political parties were accepted. These four political parties are the following: CPDM, six lists in the following regions: Center, Littoral, North, Northwest, South, and Southwest. SDF, seven lists in the following regions: Adamawa, Center, Northwest, North, Southwest, West, and South. CDU, one list in the West. NUDP, three lists in the following regions: Littoral, North, Adamawa. The following lists were rejected: ANDP, 3 lists in the Far North, South, Southwest. FSNC, 2 lists in the Adamawa and the North. MDR, 1 list in the Far North. CPDM, 4 lists in the Adamawa, Far North, East and West regions. SDF, 1 list in the Littoral. NUDP, 3 lists in the center, Far North, Northwest. UPC, all 9 lists as follows: 2 in the Littoral, 3 in the center, 1 in the Far North, 1 in the West, 1 in the South, 1 in the Southwest region.
All 9 lists submitted by the 3 factions of the UPC party were rejected by ELECAM. None of the 3 factions had an authorization from the Ministry of Territorial Administration. The SDF list for the Littoral region was rejected because the candidate failed to legalize some documents. 4 lists of the CPDM party were rejected in the West, the Far North, Adamawa and East regions due to errors in the certification of documents. The story is almost same for the rest of the political parties. The candidates of Minister Chiruma's CNSF party were underaged, while some parties had no female candidates. Some could not pay the 1 million deposit.
I will introduce a request, a plea to understand the reason why such a thing has taken place. But in case it is not possible, okay, then we will accept the verdict.
Ndamjoya of the CDU had no problem. His lone list in the West region was accepted.
We read the text and we prepare our list in consequence. That is very important, because sometimes we are not doing by adventure. We are doing because we know it is very serious, and our candidates and all documents they have to provide were there, and we have chosen our candidate.
A total of 17 lists were accepted, 23 were rejected. Petitions relating to the rejection may be brought before the Constitutional Council within a maximum period of 2 days following the publication of the results. At some Yaounde ELECAM branches Wednesday, some councillors who constitute the Electoral College of the April 14 senatorial show up to collect their voters' card.
Nous sommes fiers d'être les tout premiers électeurs, j'allais dire les grands électeurs.
Political parties are anxiously waiting for the publication of the final list of parties retained by ELECAM for the April 14 senatorial. The re-election of Kavai as House Speaker leaves some MPs of the opposition indifferent.
It is the CPDM who wants the representative named Kavaye to be president. So they decided they have the majority. We don't have anything to say.
The CDU MP is demanding the effective implementation of an internal rule of the House that all political parties in the assembly be represented in the bureau.
You see that there are some political parties present at the National Assembly which are not represented in the bureau. Even when we are represented like CDU, you see there are a lot of, we have a president, 5 vice president, 4 questors and 12 secretaries. But see which political parties has which kind of status in the bureau. It's not fair.
Other MPs of the opposition were not available to speak. However, some MPs of the CPDM party expressed joy over the re-election of their party comrade.
I am very happy because our House Speaker, Mr. Kavai Gejibril, is a man of experience. He has been there a long time ago.
They say their joy is based over his experience. Kavaye has been speaker since 1992. He's gradually getting to 40 years in the assembly as MP. His dream of becoming a senator was quashed by an undisclosed rule of his party.
Hello, I'm Jean-Paul Chouinard. I will be meeting you in a moment with Sport Focus.
Merci for the plus Jean-Paul Chouinard d'être là dans le cadre de Sports Focus.
Thank you, Mr. Solomon. It's always a pleasure for me to be part of the program, despite the fact that I was absent for a moment.
Well, nous savons que vous étiez, n'est-ce pas, convalescent. Nous allons parler avec vous des éliminatoires de la Coupe du Monde. Finalement, les gens de notre bat le Togo 2-1. On peut dire que les gens de notre se sont, n'est-ce pas, réveillés et relancés, Jean-Paul.
Yes, it's a good initiative for Lyon to have won the match against Togo, because now they are first in their group. You know, they are in the same group with Libya, Togo, Democratic Republic of Congo. But Democratic Republic of Congo, who is now playing against Libya. But if Libya win, Libya is going to be first with 7 points, but now Cameroon has 6. Anyway, people were fearing that Cameroon could not win the encounter
C'est
against
pas
Togo.
Chance ou ils ont mérité la victoire.
No, they cannot say that it was by chance that they won the match, because the Lions play seriously. And we saw what Samuel Eto'o, the captain, team captain, did. He scored 2 goals, and the first one was a penalty shot. People might say that it was a penalty. Any player could score. Yes, it's a goal. And when Togo equalizes, Cameroon was quite hopeless. That the encounter is going to be a draw. But at the unexpected moment, Samuel Eto'o, on his own, in his own old style, he scored a second goal when people were not expecting.
Alors parlons un peu de l'ambiance dans la tanière de Lyon. Tantôt Samuel Eto'o dit qu'il y a menace sur sa vie. Tantôt il dit que c'est pas ce qu'il a dit. Finalement, il joue à quel jeu? Quelle est l'ambiance dans la tanière de Lyon et notamment Jean Pochou?
No, the problem is that about this Samuel Eto'o issue matter, he said it before, so many months before, and he said that his life was in danger because of the officer of Cameroon Football Federation. They wanted to assassinate him. He said it, but nobody. Nobody cares. So Mr. Samuel Eto'o naturally has put a kind of dispositif to protect himself. Now they were saying that he came with his food, water, and everything.
For who and talks?
That is the question, because nobody can say whether they saw his load of food and water and things people said. But now the ambience inside the
Lions den.
The Lions is something which concerns the dressing room, as they say in French, ça concerne les vestiaires. So, but the most important now is not to look on what is happening now, but is now to try to build on a good team,
reconstruire l'équipe.
Yes, and you know the problem within the Lions is the matter of. Relationship are very hard, and they have to make them be peaceful. So we may expect that for the coming matches, we'll be having a good team like the one we saw yesterday. But there are some certain things that they have to readjust, like the defense line.
Quoi? Donc il y a un problème au niveau de la défense.
Defense line. But yesterday we saw the couple Nicolas Nkuna and Jean-Amel Kanabik. There was a kind of misunderstanding between the two players. So
j'espère qu'ils vont revoir, n'est-ce pas, le match, et puis ils vont améliorer, n'est-ce
surely.
Pas,
and, the head coach, Mr. Jean-Paul Akono, surely has taken note concerning that aspect.
On parle à présent du championnat national de première division. Nous sommes déjà à la quatrième journée. Est-ce qu'il y a de quoi mettre sous les dents?
No, exactly. Now the situation is that we are playing the fifth day is going to be is now have been played, and the major aspect in this the classification table is that Astra is still the first with 10 points, followed by Unisport Wankam. Third, Coton Sport of Garoua, 8 points. And Dual Athletic 2000, who just got in first division championship this year, is. Yes, it's a great surprise. And at the bottom of the classification table, we have Renaissance Gumu. Panthé Dundé, 2 points. And Fovo Bahan, 2 points. Fovo Bahan, who played against Union Douala and was beaten hollow, 3-0. And so that is the situation.
Est-ce qu'il y a les équipes qui ont, n'est-ce pas, présenté des surprises par rapport à ce championnat?
Yes, exactly. I was talking about Dual Athletic 2000, oui, which is a great surprise because the team is sharing the same rank with Coton Sport of Garoua.
So, une équipe.
Yes, and so a team who just got into first division championship, which is at that level, I think is something very, very appreciable.
Merci Jean-Fortuné d'être là dans le cadre de Sports Focus dans l'émission Midi Press.
Thank you Solomon Amoa. I hope that I will be here by next week if I don't. You know I'm still convalescent as you said a while ago.
Merci une fois de plus Jean-Fortuné.
Thank you, it was a great pleasure for me.
Thanks too for being there. Time for us to welcome our guest. Thank you immensely for staying with us. We are now with our guest. He is the chairman of the leading opposition party in Cameroon. I'm talking about the SGF chieftain, Ni John Frundi. Welcome to join us, chairman.
Thank you, Amabo.
How do we call you, chairman, Ni John? Which do you prefer, chairman?
I think for 23 years you've been calling me. Call me with a name that suits you better.
I'm going to be interviewing you with Charles Fungang. He works with the press agency, Jad Cameroon. Time for you to welcome our guest, Charles.
C'est un honneur pour moi de participer à ce programme en compagnie du chairman Ni John Frundi.
Chairman, we begin by asking you your appraisal of the way things are unfolding with regard to the senatorial election since the Electoral College was convened.
You know, before the Electoral College was convened for the senatorial elections, I was on the field struggling to convince Cameroonians to get their names inscribed on the electoral register. You know that there's quite a lot of disenfranchisement. The voters are party in our country, and especially the young people. But in the areas that I passed, the registration rate increased, the percentage increased. So I still want to use this media to call on the young Cameroonians that they should please do everything to get their names inscribed on the electoral register. You see, we had a falsified or a false electoral register before, where we had over 8 million people registered. And during the presidential elections, you saw the tons of uncollected voters' cards that were left behind, which means those were false names. And with the false approach, they've given free identification papers to people, calling on them to have this free identification and register. But we see that the people are not coming. Even those that have come, the young people who have come, who've reached up to age, we cannot get up to that 8 million people that registered in the last presidential elections. With the call of the senatorial elections, I did draw Mr. Biya's attention to the fact that he himself was not ready. Cameroonians were not ready. We've not really organized ourselves. And while the SDA was still arguing on the modalities, the degree of preparedness, he summoned the senatorials immediately.
Yes.
Effectivement, ni John Fundi, j'aimerais savoir quelle appréciation donc, appréciation générale, vous faites donc de l'organisation des sénatoriales depuis que le corps a été convoqué par le président de la République.
Now, my appraisal was that it was ill-timed. Cameroonians hadn't enough time to prepare themselves. While the SDF was still arguing that we should have good modalities to organize the senatorials, which are the upper house of Cameroon, Mr. Biya called them immediately. I mean, you will see today that in the despite the fact that when he called, the CPDM had over a month to prepare themselves, they still rejected the files in four regions. Whereas the SDF took 5 days to compile their files, and we managed to compile files in 8 regions. And out of these 8, 7 have gone through, which shows the degree of unpreparedness, even in the CPDM camp.
Now, Chairman, each time you meet the president, you make declarations as to the fact that you are drawing his attention to the strengthening of democracy in Cameroon and about how to fine-tune the electoral process. Do you think the president actually listens to you and the opposition in Cameroon?
He listens, I'm told. But he has people around him, I'm told, who block quite a lot of these things. And that's why I tell him that, well, he should be a president to put his foot down.
You want to name names of people who are blocking maybe the things you might have expected the president to put in place?
If you ask me in the SDF, I can tell you that maybe this person or that person is blocking me. But in the CPDM, I think that they have to name themselves. I cannot go into somebody's house and start naming people who are not letting him operate. He best knows.
Chairman John Fundi, est-ce que c'est cette impréparation, cet exercice que vous avez fait par le passé et constaté que les Camerounais n'étaient pas prêts, qui vous a amené, dès l'annonce de ces élections sénatoriales, à promettre aux citoyens camerounais que si M. Biya s'entêtait à organiser les élections, vous demanderez aux militants, à vos militants, de déguiser leur machette?
Yeah, I realized that Cameroonians got so frightened when they got to hear the name of Machet. I think I have this to say. In the 90s, we got over 3 bills of lading from Douala port here, where guns were imported into the country. We brought this out, raised it up, nobody talked. Even this year, I'm being reliably made to understand that they caught a gendarme officer escorting guns from the airport to the port here.
It was a police officer.
A police officer.
Yes, well, Chairman.
I'm happy.
They are all security forces. We have the information.
Okay, fine, lovely. So, when these guns, which is more dangerous to the society, a machete that somebody can use to clear his compound, can use to go to the farm, can use to defend himself. Because you have armed robbery now, people are breaking into houses and holding you at gunpoint and all the like. Which is more dangerous for the society, a gun or a machete?
Well, it depends on how maybe you use it, somebody want to answer. And Chairman, we read in the papers that the governor of the Northwest came to your home and saw those machetes. What have you finally done with them, Chairman?
Am I not a farmer?
You've gone to your farm.
Excuse me, am I not a farmer?
We know you are a farmer, but you bought them with the intention
of... But if I go to the governor and I meet gendarmes and police and the army with guns, I'll go and start panicking that a person who fears a machete is a thief.
Now, Chairman, we'll come to the key question of the day. When the Electoral College for the Senatorials was convened, you said the SDF, I'm quoting you, on her own, would ensure that this election doesn't take place. Then, within a fortnight, that is what you said.
You are
on record.
Excuse me.
Can play that, Chairman.
We are on record to say that the SDF will make sure that these elections don't take place if we don't sit down to talk the modalities of it with Mr.
I'm going to come back. You expected to be received in audience by the president. We were made to understand that the director of the civil cabinet, Martin Bilinga Butu, received you, and then thereafter you said you're going to take part in the senatorials, and then your legal advisor Mbandam said you're going to take part in the masquerade. So people want to understand this sudden change of gear of the SDF and the chairman in particular.
J'aimerais compléter. En fait, effectivement, est-ce que le chairman peut expliquer aux Camerounais les raisons de cette évolution de sa position après qu'il ait déclaré que le SDF n'irait pas à ces élections dans les conditions dans lesquelles elle était organisée. Et quelques temps après, on voit que la position a évolué. Qu'est-ce qui justifie cette position, cette évolution de la position?
We are an organization, an organized party. When we make statements, we sit down in NEC review, and when we give the conditionalities, if Mr. Biya respected and sent somebody to talk to us, and he talked to us convincingly and we saw reasons why we should go in after the discussions, should I only say no because I've not seen Mr. Biya himself, because this and that? We talked.
What did you discuss finally?
That's
what people might want to know.
So, are you telling me that when I discourse strategies, I should come and tell the people?
But chairman, because people were surprised that the chairman who made Yaounde to somewhat panic, backtrack from his position.
I didn't backtrack. We are going in for elections and want to see those elections to be free, fair, and transparent. And if the elections are not free, fair, and transparent, they should be prepared to face the aftermath.
Would you not be kind of guarantee, même mineur, que vous avez pu obtenir après la rencontre avec le directeur général du cabinet civil de la présidence de la République?
I might not give you the full guarantees to say that this is what we discussed, these are the guarantees. Are you telling me that I should not have a gentleman's agreement with somebody?
So we should not know about the gentleman's agreement, but we are the Cameroonian people.
We are the Cameroonian people, and you have a leader.
Yes.
You trust that leader.
People trust you.
Cameroonians, okay, fine.
Majority
so
of them.
If the Cameroonian people trust me, they should be able to trust me to the end to see what we'll do.
Well, you're not explaining what you discussed at the presidency. In fact, Mr. Chairman, I want to be clear with you. We talk to people in the streets. Some say they gave the SDF chairman, they came back to the old story of giving you money. So we don't know how true is that, how much they gave you, because the sudden change of attitude leaves many Cameroonians dumbfounded, Chairman.
Et j'aimerais compléter ici que ce n'est pas la première fois que les positions du SDF évoluent.
Now, is that the first time you of the press corps are accusing Fundi that he got monies? When I had a handshake with Mr. Biya in Bamenda,
they said you took money.
One of the news agents wrote in the paper, and I have the paper with me, that when I shook hands with him, he gave me 30 million, I stopped in my jacket, and I came out moving. And the man was describing his own size, how he moves. So he thought that I will take monies. I think we've been in politics for 23 years, and Cameroonians know the man they're dealing with. And if for 23 years I've been taking monies, they will know. But even before we had the handshake, top Cameroonians, some of them holding top positions now in ELECAM, drummed their chest to say that they are talking as insiders. They want to tell you in this meeting that Fundi is whining and dining with Biya. But when I met Mr. Biya, we shook hands. All of you heard from his own voice, Mr. Chairman, it's a long time. It's a long time we've not met. I said, yes.
It's a long time means you might have been meeting.
Oh, yes, okay. Under your supervision.
No, because you say it's a long time, it's not
that's
as...
That's a long time that we've not met. As Cameroonians, we are supposed to meet.
Okay.
If I'm the chief of opposition, I see people now push me to that corner to call me chief of the opposition, which in the interest of peace and the Cameroonian people, I accept. We are supposed to meet and discuss. Because in other countries where they are talking of democracy, the head of state talks with the opposition. They have to do certain things together. But in Cameroon, where the CPDM is Mr. Know-All, they are saying they know everything and they cannot ask any opinion from the opposition.
Généralement, Chairman, quand vous rencontrez donc ces responsables, ces cadres du RDPC ou encore le chef de l'État, qu'est-ce que vous dites? Et qu'est-ce qu'il vous dit également? Quelles sont les promesses qu'il a eu à faire et qui ne seraient pas respectées?
The promise is a gentleman's agreement. And this will be seen by Cameroonians when the results do come true. But for me to stand before the Cameroonians and start justifying myself, oh, you see, I went met him, this is what we discussed, this is what he has given me, and all the like, I don't think that this is the proper...
Some even think that you have been promised the post of senator, either by appointment or you might simply win.
No, so excuse me.
What are your chances of winning, Chairman?
I think that Cameroonians could have known Fundi, that Fundi is not somebody to take... to take the plate. I'm a field politician. I'm going in for elections.
And you're sure to win. You're sure to win from the confidence you have.
Quelles sont les garanties?
Are you the one asking that question?
Because the majority of people know from the papers, from opinion polls, people are sure that the remake of 1988, Frondi is eventually going to win. So,
okay, do you know that? Then why do you still ask?
I want to ask you, in case you don't win and you are appointed.
Excuse me, sir.
Because we have to be...
If I don't win and the elections are free, fair, transparent, fine.
Okay.
Peut-être qu'on revienne sur les élections sénatoriales. Dans le Nord-Ouest, où vous êtes déclaré candidat, le RDPC a la majorité des conseils municipaux. Et qu'est-ce qui vous fait quoi pour gagner les élections? Et si vous ne les gagnez pas et que vous êtes nommé sénateur par le président de la République, allez-vous siéger au Sénat?
You know that the elections of the Northwest, even in Santa, were highly contested. And we proved the double registration, double voting, where people would take about 10 cards, put in 10 envelopes, fold them together, stand from a distance, show you, you'll see that this is one envelope, they go drop. So the results of the Northwest are not true. And the SDF stands a chance of having a landslide victory in the Northwest. Because the people they try to craft into the CPDM and get them registered under the CPDM. Most of them are not CPDM militants. And the Northwesterner, whether in the SDF or in the CPDM, first is a Cameroonian. And they know where the truth is.
The last part of the question. The chairman is still somehow evading the question.
Which question?
The question, in case you don't win in the Northwest, the SDF does not emerge victorious. And then the chairman is appointed by the president. It can happen. What would you eventually
do? Excuse me, sir. Did you call me here to wish me bad luck?
No, chairman, everybody,
yes, told
you.
Yes, you called me to wish me bad luck.
Not to wish you bad luck.
I am telling you, and I'm telling all Cameroonians,
that you're going to win.
That the SDF will win in the Northwest landslide.
Come with me.
We see.
No, he said that we, by insisting on the question, it seems we are wishing him ill luck. So we leave the chairman to walk towards the victory of his party in the Northwest. Charles, we're about to ask the chairman how important is his Senate for the SDF party.
And also for the campus, également pour le Cameroun.
Yeah, and for Cameroon.
If Mr. Biya is able to open his mouth to say this man has embezzled, that man has embezzled, it's because of the presence of the SDF in parliament. And if the SDF goes into Senate with a good majority given by the Cameroonian people, I am going into parliament myself. They should give us that majority and they'll see what we'll do.
Comment ferez-vous pour avoir cette majorité quand on sait que dans les régions comme le Sud, où votre parti est candidat, vous ne comptez aucun conseiller municipal?
The present elections are not going on party lines. It's an election where Cameroonians are voting men and women of honor and dignity to represent them in that upper house. We are not voting this person because it's SDF, because it's CPDM, because it's UNDP. You are voting somebody you think can represent your interest in that upper house. And for 23 years, Cameroonians know. And to come back to it, I've won the elections all through, though they're rigged. You will not tell me that the elections that are being rigged because I've won are not just SDF people voting for Frondi.
Your initial argument why you never wanted senatorial to take place before the municipal election was that the mandate of the municipal councillors had expired. Now you accepted to go to the polls. Does that solve the problem of the illegitimacy of their mandate?
If we didn't go, you saw how many parties already filed their applications to go in without having councillors. If the SDF didn't come in to do this check, of course, you know the situation in Cameroon. It's just a matter of giving this party 2, giving that one 5, giving that one 3, giving that one this number. And of course, Mr. Biya comes up with almost 90%. But with the presence of the SDF, we'll make sure that we'll fight as usual to see what we can do to turn the tables. I think I'm calling first on Cameroonians to be very vigilant. After all, the electorate in the senatorial elections is small. The few councillors that will come, the people should be nearby there to see what they are doing. Because if they are to bring dead councillors
to come vote,
they will make sure that they don't vote.
Certaines vos listes ont été disqualifiées, Chairman. Quelles sont les dispositions qui ont été prises au niveau de votre parti pour vous assurer que cela sera remis en compétition?
It was only one list because we didn't file in the east and we didn't file in the north. And the parties that filed in the east and far north, their lists were disqualified. They disqualified the list of the CPDM because they said they had a Chadian on.
Yes.
And that answers my, I'm vindicated, that answers my cry. Because I cried and told Elecam that they were registering foreigners in the present electoral process.
Yes.
And when you register these foreigners, of recent we had the Boko Haram approach to the abduction of French citizens in the north, which we condemn. Those people must have Cameroonian identification papers. That when they pass, they should.
There's an insinuation.
It's not an insinuation. So are you telling me that the Cameroon security, their own is only out looking for Frundi to see what he's doing? I'm going to the 20th,
celebration
anniversary, and they have to send me through a scanner, search me. I told them that I'm not a security risk. So their own approach is to screen Frundi. And you cannot screen foreigners that will come right into Cameroon land
and
abduct seven French citizens, not one, seven, and drove across the borders into Nigeria. They must be Cameroonians. Or foreigners with Cameroonian identity cards. And this is what we are crying. To say that the Cameroonian identity card has been prostituted, everybody who cares. When they came up with a new identity card, I met with a Nigerian in Magwa. We were talking. He said, look, I have my new identity card. I removed it and showed. Then one of my boys looked at his face and said, you are a smuggler. He said, sir, don't say that. I'm a struggler, not a smuggler. You know, but that was a Nigerian with the Cameroonian identity card.
Now, Charles, we'll take a breather before you come back to pose your question. And as we initially discussed, Chairman, the talk within a week and some days ago was in the Bakassi Peninsula, where some locals there actually brutalized or burnt down the Maritime Brigade in protest against the local authorities there, whom they claim increased the taxes. We hear so far 11 Nigerians are waiting trial at the Boya production prison. By the wake of all that standoff, Davidson Maimo visited the Bakassi Peninsula. He came back with this special report.
When many out the year of Bakassi, what immediately comes into their mind is war. But little one believe that life is so interesting in this part of the country, just like what we are finding behind me. It is the youth of Jabane and that of Idiabato. Life in Bakassi is not what people think out, as of course there is total peace, cohesion between the inhabitants of this vicinity.
Both Cameroonians and Nigeria are living in harmony.
I see many development, especially house. They build many houses here. The thing where remain for them to do is secondary school for a year. They have to give us better route to go the other side.
Army where they here, we thank God for them for their protection. They guide us well. No problem. Yeah, as far as I am here, I am a Cameroonian. Yeah.
But the bone of contention here is at the special force, the Battalion Intervention Rapide, that have taken over from the Marines some 5 years ago, beating up and torturing Nigerians, as rumored.
And said they have done so well for us.
Oh.
I mean the B. Because the reason I'm saying, because I'm the interpreter of Kombe Berumu. Then I have seen since London, I'm here with us. they are the helping us with many facilities, with health and education.
I so much thank the government of Cameroon. You can see here we have a public pump here. But during the time of Nigeria, we not have this kind of a thing.
The head of the Cameroonian community in Idiabato, who have lived there for more than 30 years, say the Cameroon Special Force, the Bill Delta, have done a lot in terms of security, and cooperation with the military is very cordial.
I'm Chief Paul Chenko, the Cameroonian chief of Idiabato. We are feeling well, there's no problem. And we are living with our brothers, Nigerians, as brother and brother. The security are doing their best because they are reducing the piracy. Because before, you cannot travel from here to Jabane. They will track you in the road and collect all your money and their goods. They were killing people anyhow. When the bee came, reduce all those bad boys. Before the hospital come here, if you're sick, you go there, they will treat you free. And even some, even you want to go to upland, like Edina, if you, that's their destination, they will take you free.
The Nigerian paramount chief of Idiabato equally buttressed the point on security.
Chief Jonathan Okun, the paramount chief of Idiabato subdivision. Something you don't change. Very, very big change for security. About security, we do for we fine, fine.
My name is Mrs. Amy Njong Efia.
Yes.
Idiabato now is good for us because we get something to eat now. Number one, the problem we get about 6-7 years ago, we don't even have it now. Like armed robber, we no see. Like fight, we no see. The reason why the armed robber no dey is because of security for being where he guide us.
In a visit to the third class chief at Jabane 2, Chief Samson, his warm welcome interpret that all is well. But why is the Bill Delta, instead of being the war machines as rumored, is interested in the well-being of the community as expressed by both Cameroonians and Nigerians living within this area? John Williams is a major with the Bill Delta.
I'm talking on behalf of the colonel who is commanding the Rapid Intervention Battalion Delta. Bill Delta is a highly professional unit, a highly operational unit too, that is just abiding by the principle of its mission. Its mission is to protect the Bakassi Peninsula and to safeguard the national interest on high sea. So in doing this, there are many actions that the B Delta has to lead. Now that we are within the transitional period of the Green Tree Agreements, there are many missions that we can call operations other than war that we are bound to lead here towards the population. Those are mostly actions in favor of the population, humanitarian actions. This is why we admit people in our camp here in Jabane, for example, to have water, because we have a water treatment facility that treats water and makes it portable. You know, giving benches, giving textbooks to students. And there's a full tournament that we did organize on the 11th of February, just to show the cohesion between us and the population.
The Cameroon military has equally provided piped water to some of the communities. Some buildings have also been constructed by the Cameroon government after a fire outbreak that consumed almost the entire Jabane one.
The time where the fire, they burn the house, this is our people, Cameroon people, they build this house and give us for free to stay for 3 years before.
Mm. But what are some of the problems the people are facing? The divisional officer for Ijabato subdivision explained.
The only problem we have is that there are people who do not like that relationship that is existing. They don't want to hear that the people are fine with the administration here, with the forces. So they try to fabricate things. And when they fabricate things, there are people, they manipulate, they go and they give information which is not found, information which is not founded. Because we are here as authorities. They come to us with their problems. We make sure that we solve their problem. We intervene when they have problems. But we hear serious things coming out from, you know, from Nigeria, especially some pressmen, they say things which are not founded. So, and they forget to understand that when something happens here, we verify. But at the level of my office and at the level of the gendarmerie and even the people, we don't have any problem with any member of the population of the Nigerian community.
Health-wise, both the government of Cameroon and the Bill Delta are said to be working relentlessly towards this direction. A health center has been constructed at Ijabato, while the B Delta Health Unit at Jabane is for both the population and the military.
I am standing right at the beach of Ijabato between the military, be it the gendarme or the police, and the youth of this area. It tells you the cordial relationship that exists between the people of this particular area. It tells you that development is what is being projected. It tells you that peace is what the people are vying for.
The visit of the Canadian High Commissioner to Cameroon, to Bakassi, goes a long way to prove that Cameroon has indeed respected all the Green Tree Agreement and is simply waiting to fully take control of what belongs to her come the 14th of August.
New Canada is quite pleased, has been always quite pleased about the agreement that has been reached to achieve peace in the Bakassi area. This has been achieved through a peaceful process, and Canada has been always seeing it as an example for peace and mitigation.
The Elecam head for Ijabato subdivision says some of the inhabitants who are not Cameroonians are eager and willing to register to vote.
Yes, we can't register them because they have not naturalized. That's the problem. Until when government will give them that okay to naturalize and they have their document which are valid, they will do that.
It's equally left for doubting Thomases to visit Bakassi.
Thanks once again for staying with us, and thank you, Davidson Memo, with that special report on what is happening in the Bakassi Peninsula. Now, Chairman, you watch with us the peace which has been reported in the Bakassi Peninsula in the wake of some minute tension at times. The question is, do you think the government is doing enough to make Bakassi actually belong to Cameroon, or to push people or cause people to go reside there?
You see, we are talking about a difficult situation. The average Nigerian in Bakassi who was born and bred there would not want to see how he was born and bred there, as I was talking about the street children here.
Yes.
Tomorrow you tell them to go to Nigeria. I think the government should put in more efforts to bring dialogue. The Nigerians there have been doing their free fishing, running away from Nigerian taxes and all the like. Now, Cameroon comes in, you have to pay taxes, you have to live under the law. Bakassi was first a free, no man's land. So, but if you go there now and you want to bring these heavy laws, you have to be gradual. And if there's one thing, I must be frank to say this very open to Cameroonians, that the average Nigerian Igbo hates in Cameroon is the gendarme. Because before the approach of politics where the gendarmes lessened the high-handedness of treating people, a gendarme would meet you knowing that you are a foreigner. You have to bring your resident car tax, you have to bring your tax for this, you have to bring patang, you have to bring this. So up to a point where a Nigerian said, they say I pay patang, they say I bring tax, they say may I bring this, I pay patang for chop, I pay patang for house. I pay patang. So all I work my money for Cameroon is to pay patent. So, you see, I think that for Bakassi, the government should have a more peaceful approach with dialogue to bring the people in. But if they built houses for them, fine. I want to appeal, that is the first step. And they brought them schools, fine. I want to appeal, that's another step. And
you want dialogue now?
I want dialogue.
Yeah.
And the gendarmes there should be very careful. Because
they are warning gendarmes, Chairman.
No, yes, I want them to be careful that they should not think that they will treat the people of Bakassi the way they will treat you here in Douala. You people here, the press, you use your press to attack Frundi. It's Frundi.
People report facts, Frundi.
What type of
people,
facts?
People cannot attack you.
What type of facts?
The other time.
Please, what I'm saying is that the slightest issue in Bakassi, the Nigerian press drums it up. You have from the universities, from the trade unions, from the lawyers, from this and that. They start telling you how small Cameroon like that we can rap with Ogbono and Swallow is there beating Nigerians in Bakassi. Let us go and just crush Cameroon down and take even right up to Bamenda.
There's international law, Chairman. You cannot,
the international law is there, but that to please, happen. You also have the international law on human rights.
And si le chairman avait la dirigé ce pays, quelle politique mettrait en place pour sécuriser cette zone de Bakassi? Vous avez un shadow cabinet. Quelle est la politique qu'avez-vous pensé pouvoir mettre en place pour sécuriser cette région?
No, my shadow cabinet minister already addressed the situation in Bakassi and the situation in the north. They address all this. And the shadow cabinet minister can only work as a shadow cabinet. He cannot take a government position. And their place, their role is to watch government business, criticize, and propose a way forward. But the unfortunate thing is that sometimes instead of the government officials inviting the shadow cabinet to say that we've seen you write this, what are you people proposing? So that from there we start working. They want to steal the idea and try to implement it.
And then claim they are the original
authors. Authors of that idea. And since the idea from the onset is not their own idea, they always have this haphazard
way of implementing it.
Way of implementing, not implementing it to details. And that's why we have the situation the way it is in the country.
Yeah.
But what I'm still proposing is that for the Bakassi Peninsula thing, please, can we give dialogue a chance?
That Bakassi issue was just an asset in a discussion. We're not talking, we are with an opposition political party leader. We want to talk about the opposition in Cameroon. Since the rebirth of multipartism, we realized that the opposition is finding it difficult to unite itself. We saw it in 2004 with the National Coalition for Reconstruction and Reconciliation, where we saw the SDF chairman simply leaving the hall in anger that he was not chosen, or rightly or wrongly, as a candidate to represent the opposition. So what is the difficulty in the Cameroonian opposition uniting itself, Chairman, and accusing fingers are pointing at the SDF, and notably the chairman, of always wanting to be at the forefront?
Right. I'm glad that you are talking in a country where we make njangis. I don't know whether you want that somebody who contributes njangis of 5 million should contribute it to somebody who has only 10,000 to contribute. You carry 5 million and give him, knowing that you cannot. What people fail to understand is that Cameroonians now have a free mind. They know what they want. They know whom they want to choose. And as we said before, you cannot have a river flowing into a sea and it tells that sea that change your name from
the
Red Sea, the Mediterranean Sea, to River Nile. No, that cannot happen. In the presidential elections of 92, luckily I had Mr. Hamini Mbialo as my campaign manager who handled the cash. In most of the places, he struggled to give the monies for the campaign supervision or election supervision in that area to militants of his party. These people took the monies and he never saw them. Because there are people who were not true militants. So, when you tell me that, look, listen, give this man the leadership, he hasn't the structures, his own structures on the field. So that in effect, you go now to meet, where's your party? Their parties are in Equinox here, where they come to talk and they
tell you. Equinox does not have any political party.
Yes, we because they come here to tell you what they think and they acknowledge you their chairman, program. So
we don't belong to any party.
There's no political party which has its party house here, chairman.
That should be made clear in the minds of our televiewers.
Look, listen. When they come here, they talk. That's when they talk their politics. Outside the television houses, outside the newspaper columns, they have no structures on the field that they can tell you that here we stand. These are my people. They can't organize rallies.
Charles had a question.
Chairman, si on vous écoute et si on vous comprend bien, pour vous, tous les groupements, toutes les tentatives de pouvoir mettre l'opposition ensemble ne pourraient que servir qu'au SDF. Et pourtant, pendant les élections de 92, on a bien vu que cette opposition-là s'était mise ensemble pour vous accompagner. Pourquoi ne pouvez-vous pas rendre l'ascenseur à ceux qui vous ont accompagné en 92 et ce qui vous a permis de gagner les élections dont la victoire avait été volée?
His question is, people supported you in 1992, opposition parties. Why haven't you ever thought of maybe giving them your own support? So
no, but I've answered this question.
That Chairman, est-ce que le SDF de 1992 qui cristallisait tous ces espoirs-là, est-ce que c'est le même SDF aujourd'hui en 2013? Pensez-vous avoir été à la hauteur des attentes des Camerounais?
Do you think you have been up to the expectations of Cameroonians and the SDF of 1992? Can you say the same SDF of nowadays?
Yeah, but that's what you, the press, you in particular of the press, you think, oh, the SDF in 92 did this, they did that. I came here in 2004. You saw that the crowd that came out here to receive me beat that of 92. The crowd that came out in Yaoundé to receive me beat that of 92.
You always pull crowds in my bed.
Yes.
Not, they don't vote.
The crowds vote. Excuse me. Let us look at the 2011,
the latest presidential elections.
Yes. Mr. Biya at his polling station, where he voted, he had above 400 registered voters. And if at that polling station, with nobody supervising, he had 88 votes, are you telling me that he won?
Well, that is just a small portion of the entire electoral core.
Right. I'm glad to hear that from you. When that small portion comes from the highest person of state, then you can now analyze and go down
what
the
happens
drain.
To the rest.
And you saw, for yourself the number of uncollected voters' cards in their tons at all the polling stations all over the country.
Now, Chairman, there's another problem people are raising. Right. Cameroonians are saying that the democracy in Cameroon seems stalled because the chairman of the various political parties, some side President Biya, who has been there since the creation of the CPDM,
right.
Major Funder of the SDF, who has been there for 23 years, mm-hmm. and the Wunder Mjoya of the CDU. So they say you are the ones who spoiling the entire process, the democratic process.
But not the SDF, because the SDF's candidate, the SDF party, is the only party that organizes conventions. And the chairman stands elections, even going to presidential elections.
People are afraid to stand. Maybe they're scared of. They might be slammed into the Article 8-2.
Oh,
that's
come
what.
On.
Dismissal.
And I've not slammed it on you with some of the issues people.
No, we're raising issues Cameroonians are itchy to know.
To know.
Chairman.
And that's why I'm telling you that the SDF's leader is the only leader who goes in for elections. He stands up, he resigns from his position, sits with his constituency, and they call him. And even before I come up to that level, we do primaries. You remember 1 year Joa challenged my candidature for chairmanship.
He backtracked at the last
meeting. No, he was defeated. When they defeat, they say, because they fear that the chairman will do this. The chairman is not a monster. Are you telling that the chairman can be stronger than all the Cameroonians that stand to watch me, or those who are looking at me tonight? That, they're stronger than Frundi.
Yeah, Frundi, no. People know you. So people even say you're not an ordinary person, because we know you even said that you were shot at bed. The bullets never attended you. They've made attempts at poisoning you. I read that in the papers. And then
yes, but equally I've recently,
you had an accident in Yaoundé.
Right.
And they've made several attempts at your own life. That's the insinuation which you give. So surviving all that, people don't take you to be an ordinary person, Chairman. Don't you think so?
Am I the only one who survived accidents? Am I the only one who survived poisoned foods and all the like? Am I the only one who's been attacked and he goes out free?
Well, it's just some views of some people. Now, Chairman, we'll go to the court. Let's take the court cases the SGF has. The first one with Marafami Duyaya and the other one with Gwadi Bule. Where are we with those cases, Chairman?
Yes, the one of Marafami Duyaya, I withdrew it out of court. And the reasons were that you are fighting somebody. And somebody else blows the man, he falls down on his stomach. And the first person he crossed to send his hand that, please help me, was you with whom he has a case. You can't hold his hand. Even if you don't succeed to lift him up, I don't think that you can take a stick again to beat him on the floor. I believe that in a boxing tournament, when you come to box me, if I box you fall, I will not follow you to beat you on the floor. I'll let you stand because we are talking of a game of men standing up to show what they can do. So he's already down on his stomach. I cannot follow him again to drag him on the floor. No.
The Dibula case?
The Dibula case, we also took Ben Muna to court because I hope the population will pardon me, because when I say this, it'll seem as if I'm already passing judgment. But the truth is that the convention that Len Gwasiri and Ben Muna organized in Yaoundé was banned by the deal. And they went under a dim light. I saw Ben Muna showing his hand up that he was the president. So when I went to Yaoundé for a press conference, I asked the journalist, how many of you were there? They hit their hands. One said he was there. I asked him, what did you see? Did you see an organized convention where they took the roll call and know that this number of people came here from this area, from this area, from this area, and they chose Ben Muna as a candidate? Then when we went to court, they said it is Frundi. Frundi said they should go and kill Dibule. Everybody said, oh, we heard Frundi. They said that Frundi said they should come and kill Dibule. Dibule, I did not know him. If I were to kill, I'd be killing Ben Muna or Ngwasiri, who were trying to split the party. Convention. I would not be killing somebody I don't know. Then they said, okay, we have a jackman. He said it's Frundi who sent Dibule. Who sent people to kill Dibule?
Kone Chinga is quoted as saying that the hierarchy of the party,
excuse me,
sent them to go put order and stop the convention from taking place.
No.
That was in 2006.
Well, I've not read that statement.
It is on record.
It's on record, but I've not seen it. And I want to talk about things I see. Colonel Chingafo was supposed to come to the convention in Bamenda. And they were supposed, the militants were supposed to gather up at the party secretariat to take off for Bamenda. If in between that something happened and somebody died. First, when I got to court, they said Dibule was killed at 6 o'clock. And the person who saw him killed at 6 o'clock is there to come testify. When the gentleman came in, he said he only passed at 11 o'clock and saw Dibule's corpse lying on the highways. And the bullet is supposed to be knocked down by a garbage truck that was going early to carry refuse from town.
Yes.
And it is being alleged that the bullet was the treasurer of Ben Muna. And the boys they brought from Briquetery to fight it out They promised them 10,000. When they only gave them 1,000, these boys were chasing Dubule to get their monies. And as Dubule was running across the road, a vehicle knocked him. That's the story that reached us. But for them to say that is Frundi who sent people to come and kill Dubule. I didn't know Dubule.
You've made abundantly clear. Charles, you had a question.
Chairman John Frundi, on vous accuse également d'être à l'origine du désordre dans le parti, notamment dans le littoral, où vous avez décidé de mettre l'honorable Ninche en disgrace.
Indigenous or what?
They said you accused of fomenting trouble in the littoral region, and you've already flawed your once vibrant honorable Jean-Michel Ninche with plans even underway to make him not go back to parliament. That's what they're saying, Chairman.
That's what they're saying. Does Frundi come to control the voting pattern in Douala? I don't come to control the voting pattern in Douala. The unfortunate thing about politics is that when you don't do your work well, you blame the man at the top.
So Ninche
ça dit que Ninche ne fait pas bien son travail, c'est vrai.
Well, it's the results of an election that make us know that a person is working. You know that, for instance, the presidential parliamentary elections that took Ninche to parliament, we lost all over Litoral. And they had to rerun.
In Douala 5.
In Douala 5. And that's when I came down and carried out the campaigns myself. Not only carrying out the campaigns, but we fought to make sure that the fraud that used to take place was blocked.
And he won.
And that's why we won for them to go in. I was not fighting for myself, I was fighting for the people.
So how far is the coordination committee now, which is in charge of Litoral?
Now, the coordination committee is to put things right, to make sure that all this infighting doesn't take place. And of course, look, please take note that we are in a political party where it's a game of interest. People want to drag for themselves. It's not sometimes as stupid as I am that, oh, I said I was not going to go into council to be a mayor, or I was not going to go to parliament, and I've allowed them go for 3 terms, that's 15 years. It's only now that I think, let me go into Senate and start
hitting. From chairman to senator, people are saying that maybe you seem to have lost focus because...
Right. Well, let the people come and do their own. Let them do with the other political parties. Let me see what they've done.
Quelle est l'appréciation que le chairman fait de l'action, de l'activité de l'honorable Ninche pendant tout ce temps qu'elle a passé à la tête de SD Littoral? Vous le connaissez sûrement très bien.
Things have not been going well in Littoral. And we sat in neck and took the position. Choose the committee. Can you go down to the field to see what is happening? And this committee is headed by the national organizing secretary of the party.
Mr. Ferdinand Asamgu.
Ferdinand Asamgu.
Yeah.
So if they come and there are problems, they resolve them. If there are no problems, they will stamp their, put their stamp to say that everything is moving fine. So when you think that, oh, there are problems in the Littoral, there are problems in the SDF.
And fingers are pointing at the chairman.
Est-ce que c'est cette position-là, est-ce que c'est cet activisme de Ninche qui lui a valu sa place, qui fait qu'il ne se retrouve pas dans le shadow cabinet? Nous le savons très actif, nous, dans la presse, mais on se rend bien compte qu'il n'en fait pas partie.
Oh, his political party is also in the press.
Who's
political? Because you said some politicians, their political party is in the press.
Of course, yes.
So is Ninche one of them?
No, I didn't say. I said political leaders. Okay. I didn't say people of the SDF.
Okay.
Now, Wafo is in the press. He's one of the shadow cabinet.
And we've been seeing how he's been stimulating the communication department.
Okay. So are you saying that that's his own political party that is formed?
One never knows whether tomorrow may better. Now, I don't know.
But
what
people who have done that, people to whom we've given the chance, projected and promoted them, they come to the press, talk this, talk that. People tell them that we are talking very well, you can form your own party. They've gone and formed parties. Where are they?
Chairman, because of the week, we noticed that the SDF, rightly or wrongly, is bereaved. We're talking about the death of Vincent Feko. I don't know whether he's one of the founding fathers of the SDF, as some people want to make believe. What do you know about Vincent Feko?
No, Vincent Feko is one of the founding members of the SDF. He's one of those who was arrested in Douala here with Yondo Black, Albert Mokong, and imprisoned. And thereafter, when we, those of us who were out fought and were released, he came back into the fold of the party. We will not take for granted what he did here in Douala to get the party implanted. And but after some time, people have their own different feelings. He thought that the SDF was not fighting the Anglophone problem properly. So he preferred going on to SCNC. We said, okay, fine. In every struggle, people have different approaches. For instance, when the SCNC first met in Boya, they nominated me as an advisor.
Have you been advising them?
Of course, I do. And they've not held any other meeting to say, Frundi, we've removed you as advisor. So I still stand as advisor.
Now, Vincent Feko, before he died,
was a founding father of the party. And he retracted into SNC. But that did not erase his name.
As a founding father.
As a founding father.
Quelle est votre position? Vous avez parlé du SNC. Quelle est votre position par rapport à ce mouvement de SNC?
My position about the movement of the SNC is that Mr. Biya should give a listening ear to the SNC.
Chairman, before Vincent Feko died, he had the following declarations which I want us all to listen to. He is a man who has passed on, but he left this declaration.
There is no doubt that there was plebiscite. But I'm saying that that plebiscite was a declaration of intention. That presidency had to alternate. The fact of the matter is that there was no unification because the prescriptions were never fulfilled. Marginalization and domination, these are all the proofs of the occupation. It is as a result of the occupation that we can now see the occupation manifested. Whatever we are doing clandestinely. We are doing clandestinely because there is no way, there is no opening for the English-speaking people to meet. In fact, the meeting in Boya at St.
You're talking about the all Anglophone conference?
Yes.
In 1993?
It was something spontaneous. Mm. But this is a regime that is intransigent, that is inert to dialogue, that does not respect anything, does not even respect its own laws.
That was the veteran politician Vincent Feko, and you heard from the SDF chairman, who was the founding father of the Social Democratic Front. Now, the last part of this program we dedicated to major happenings in Cameroon. First, chairman, in few words, we hear some people arrested in Bamenda, seven of them, and we hear there may be alleged child traffickers. So we saw you two on the spot. What is the situation now with the 30 kids and the seven men and their wives picture by security forces?
The people are being investigated and the truth is coming out because it's such a nasty moral situation where this man who's had 30 children is having children from about three sisters and the mother. And he sort of brainwashed the other men with him to believe that God has chosen him to be the person to bring to produce the next generation.
So investigations are still underway in that particular matter?
Yeah, the investigations are still underway. I'm not a lawyer, I'm not an investigator.
You're just an observer.
On vous a néanmoins vu protéger ces personnes accusées d'avoir posé ces actes?
No, if I protect a person, is to let the police have that person's life to investigate and find out the truth.
Yeah.
You see, when you kill a person who has committed a crime, you destroy evidence because we'll not know how many of such houses are there in Cameroon. Who is where doing the same thing? So when you investigate, you'll be able to have the dragnet to get all the people together so that we solve the problem.
Thank you, sincerely, Chairman. With you, we can go on, but this last worry. Have you sent the foodstuff you promised to the victims of flood in the north?
Yes, the first vice took care of that. I'll be talking with him tonight to find out exactly what is done.
I want to thank you sincerely, Charles, for coming to interview the chairman. Thank you sincerely for your time.
Thank you, everyone.
Chairman, thank you too sincerely for accepting our invitation. We are so grateful.
Well, my quarrel with you people is that when you notice that I'm very tired and after going through so much, you want to come tantalize me with your questions, but nonetheless, it was very interesting and I thank you very much for that.
It's a pleasure. We do hope to have you some other time.
Well, I'm always available.
Thank you to televiewers for being with us all this while. We do hope to bring you another brand new program. Same time next week. God bless you all. Bye-bye.